Money, greed, and the lure of winning big. The World Lottery Association estimates that the illegal gambling market is worth 90 billion US dollars annually, and Asia accounts for most of it. You can bet on almost anything, from pigeons to sports, and few escape the trap of gambling addiction. This billion-dollar shadow economy is run by criminal organizations, driving society into moral decline, destroying families, and at worst, lives. Gambling has long been considered one of the ills of society. An activity that authorities worldwide have sought to control, if not eradicate. Across Asia, gambling laws are strictly enforced, but millions still flout the law, and gambling addiction is widespread. Seemingly innocent games of chance easily turn ordinary people into pathological gamblers, whose lives become consumed by a single obsession: winning the jackpot. But gambling today is no longer confined to casinos and racetracks. The internet has become the front line of illegal betting, where money can easily change hands at the touch of a button. For more than 2 years, 23-year-old Tan has been an online bookie for an illegal gambling website in Taiwan, taking bets on just about anything.
So, 各欧洲的足球啊，然后美国职棒啊，台湾职棒。 日本棒球、韩国棒球、曲棍球，然后台湾的大乐透，各国的股市几乎都有在做。我们目前做下注的动作啊，那是先在网络上他先下一个金额，跟我们通知说他这注要下到多少钱。The
website makes it easy for gamblers to place their bets and allows criminal bookies to keep track of countless wagers. Money is passed between the gamblers and the website managers by bank transfers or by hand when possible to avoid leaving any incriminating trace. For the owners of the illegal business, these underground activities can be highly profitable.
那到开盘结束，我们每周结算的时候再跟他做收注的动作。那比如说，如果他这周是他赢了，那我们就会送现金过去给他。那如果
The website is set up outside of Taiwan to avoid detection from authorities. The shady online bookies take every precaution to make sure they stay one step ahead of the cops. Identities of new clients are checked thoroughly before they're given an account number and password to use the website.
我们这属于一个在网络上比较封闭的团体啊，要参加到这个封闭的这我们这样的社团中啊，那你需要比较需要是说跟我们要验证核对你的身份。起先我们会核对身份之外，就是我们也会去看是不是所谓就是条子派来的人。For
some, entering into the realm of illegal gambling can be the first step into the violent underworld of crime, where morality takes a backseat to money.
The trend of pathological gamblers is that society is beginning to realize now that there are this group of people who get hooked onto gambling to such an extent that they cannot break free. When you do not get what you are looking for in your gambling, it can have tragic outcomes. For example, you may resort to violence.
In the Taiwanese capital of Taipei, on the 12th of September 2011, a 20-year-old owner of an illegal gambling business was brutally murdered. Zhang Qingming was hit by a car, dealt a brutal blow to the head, and was then stabbed 10 times by one of his clients, a gambling addict. Zhang's body was later discovered in the trunk of his own car.
我们当时派员到现场查看的时候，啊，车子里面哦是有一个棉被，那从外观来看，车子的叶子板那里是有血迹。 Incredibly,
the killer posts a confession on Facebook. Just 2 days later, police track down Huang Jingqi and arrest him. Officers are stunned to confront a seasoned gambling addict, age just 17. Further interrogation revealed that the murder was viciously premeditated.
整个案情都说明得非常的清楚，一个犯案的过程，我整个非常的详细。这个部分，我们可以大概研判应该就是一个预谋杀人的一个状况。
Huang described the crime to his interrogators in detail. It all began with a simple bet on a baseball match. Teenager Huang loses the bet and owes his bookie Zhang $330. Zhang takes his car to meet the young man and demands payment.
死者跟凶嫌有谈判过，他在车上是有讲过你到底有没有钱，然后又扬言说你是耍我，然后扭打的过程，他就从口袋里面拾那个预藏的一个刀，就以棒糖的方式，就往他的脖子跟头部连刺，大概有十几刀之多，实在是太残忍了。
Trapped in a debt he could not repay, Huang claimed that he feared for his life and had no other choice but to kill Zhang.
至于这个为什么要杀人，据这个少年他是说，因为他欠下的赌债，并且被扬言说可能要开枪，甚至要杀死他。那他说，如果说他不杀他的话，
Huang's case is currently in the courts. If his plea of self-defense fails, Huang is too young to be given the death penalty, but still faces a minimum of 10 years in jail. The murder is a grisly reminder of the deadly consequences of gambling addiction, but it also sheds light on a disturbing regional trend.
In some of the youth surveys in Singapore and in Hong Kong, we found that the rates of pathological gambling or problem gambling among youths would be twice that of the adult population. That means something between 7 to 8%.
There is mounting evidence that the billion-dollar gambling industry is targeting a younger generation like Huang. In Asia, gamblers under the age of 18 are 2 to 3 times more likely to become addicted. The hard facts are frightening.
我今年18岁，已经玩线上赌博，已经玩2年了。我当时是朋友介绍才接触网络上赌博这块。我通常下注都是下 美国棒球，还有台湾棒球，美国 NBA， 之前下过，就一个礼拜都输啊，输6-7万有。
The vast demand for illegal betting in Asia is now the lifeblood of major criminal networks. Empowered by huge profits, these syndicates are not afraid to seek out new markets. The Taiwanese mafia has now turned its attention to the nation's favorite competitions, buying professional athletes and fixing matches for million-dollar payoffs. In Taiwan, where virtually all forms of gambling are illegal, a betting underworld is in full operation. Obsessive gamblers can bet on almost anything.
赢的钱也不多嘛，但是除非你碰到坏天气，最多我赢过一次就是2-3百万，就这样。Pigeon
racing is a uniquely Taiwanese hobby. Specially trained pigeons are registered with racing associations for major events. The pigeons are then taken aboard ships and brought out to sea where the race starts and the cages are opened. The birds are trained to find their way back to land along a specific route, flying over sea and mountains to a designated finish line.
台湾的那个赛鸽运动，养鸽子的这个活动了，从日据时代就开始有了。现在的比赛大概都是
海上竞价，单一季就差不多十几万只啊。
Although modest prize money is given to the winner, behind the scenes, this humble national pastime has become the source of one of the biggest illegal money-making activities in Taiwan. Thousands of huge illegal bets are placed on the races.
你没有那个三万多块，你怎么赌？啊，就算你有三万多块，那个要赢那个等数也不容易啊，啊，也要有那个鸽子。你没有那个鸽子，你赌再多钱也是输掉。
But these are no ordinary pigeons. They are the elite of the avian world, and certain birds with a history of winning races can rise dramatically in value. These champion birds can be sold at auctions for up to a mind-boggling $100,000 or more.
那个一般呢，现在最好的鸽种就是像之前以前的话，比较好的鸽种就是属于沾身系的鸽子就比较好，都是差不多从10,000美元起跳，啊，最高的话也有到100万欧元。Criminals
have come up with a new trick. Instead of risking their money by betting on the races, criminal groups now catch pigeons during the competition and hold the birds for ransom, demanding large payoffs paid in cash. It's a problem that has plagued the races for years.
我所认识的朋友做这个网鸽子的动作，差不多有一二十年，都在三网子有没有？网子是靠两个人啊，两个人就是看鸽子，如果飞过来是吧？然后网子把它拿起来，我最多看过200多只啊。Once
the birds are captured, these criminals demand hundreds or even thousands of dollars in ransom money.
一般那个养鸽子的人，他会出去外训嘛。啊，外训的时候，他都会挂地址嘛。地址完就是电话。啊，你鸽子要是有中网的话，我们就照那个电话打给对方。网鸽子，如果你通知，啊，他没有跟你通知，你那鸽子就没有可以回来了。啊，你如果钱不付，有的鸽子它脚把你剁掉，两只脚剁掉把你放回来。
很坏哦。啊，会了以后，然后我再把你的鸽子放回去。如果说遇到这个问题的话，通常的做法有很多种啊。啊，有的人是把尾巴整个给你拔掉啊，比较还有更残忍，就是把两只脚都剁掉。
It's difficult to imagine that an activity as seemingly innocent as pigeon racing would attract such a vicious criminal element. But gambling syndicates don't take chances and are always on the lookout for a guaranteed winner. Hungry for even bigger prize money, gamblers in Taiwan have turned their attention from the humble pigeon to the glamour of professional sports. In the 1990s, baseball hit new heights of popularity in Taiwan. Criminal syndicates. This was an irresistible temptation.
所以外传啊，说整每个月在台湾地下千赌金融的资金流动大概都到100亿的金额左右，所以它累积起来是一个非常庞大的一个利益。所以就很多很多的分子是基于这一块的这个法利益。
In January of 2011, Taiwanese baseball fans were stunned by the arrest of some of their biggest heroes. Top players Chen Chi-yuan and Chuang Hong-ryung, teammates at the Brother Elephants Baseball Club, were slapped with charges linking them to the crime of match fixing. As the case unfolds, the way in which baseball has been corrupted by gambling syndicates is starkly exposed. Chuang Hong-ryung was accused of negotiating a deal between gangsters and his teammates.
Chuang Hong-ryung他的角色呢，在我们俗称就是所谓的白手套。对，白手套的意思呢，就是说他是借在下赌的人。对于这些现役的球员来讲，他是一个前辈，所以这些现役的他只要去说的话，这些学弟有可能很多都会去听他的。
Now on the payroll of the powerful Taiwanese mafia, Chuang's job is to persuade his teammates to throw a game. He convinces superstar slugger Chen Chiyuan to intentionally lose a match that they were expected to win. Chuang and his associates begin to draw other players into the fold. And like mafias around the world, these criminals can be very persuasive.
他们一开始一定是先笼络你，给你好处，比如说给你钱，你是不是需要钱？好，给你钱，你要买车，没关系，我借你钱买车，然后或者是带你去上酒店，反正用各种方式去笼络你，然后最后要你跟他一起打假球。他们做法是这个样子。
其实一贯的手法就是用金钱上的诱惑嘛，金钱上的诱惑就是一个很大的对人性很大的一个考验，对啊，因为现在加上环境不是像以前，职棒元年。那时候这么好吗？我觉得薪水太少不是一个借口吧。
And it wasn't just the players that the mafia exploited. The elaborate scam involving the Brother Elephants Club reached the very highest rungs of the baseball organization and beyond.
其实主头组成也非常复杂的，有些是黑道分子，还有些是以前的就有金主有钱的人，还有地方政治人物。
Prosecutors realized that the trail of corruption extended higher and wider than anyone had imagined possible. In all, 24 people, including several baseball stars, were sentenced. But the mastermind behind the crimes turned out to be former politician Wu Chien-pao. After a three-month trial, Wu was slapped with the heaviest sentence, 7 years in prison and a fine of $330,000. Some believe Wu got off lightly.Faced with increasing levels of illegal gambling, prosecutors today fight for a maximum jail sentence of up to 10 years and fines of up to $1 million for those caught. Following this catastrophe for Taiwan's national sport, police are now monitoring games a lot more closely in the crowd and especially on the field.
那我们拍的目的，我们拍的目的就是，不是拍球赛的进行，是。拍球场内部所有的状况，我们刚才提到很多这个不法的这个集团，他下达打假球的指令是在球场内部对球员下达。
With baseball now under the close scrutiny of the authorities, gambling syndicates have begun to look for other equally lucrative targets. And with an estimated 40 million gambling addicts in Asia, ruthless criminals continue to grow their businesses.Leaving thousands of broken families and ruined lives in their wake. On the small island nation of Singapore, an estimated 80,000 gambling addicts have fueled illegal gambling operations. 23-year-old Joshua Fu knows just how these underground networks operate from firsthand experience. 6 years ago, while posing as a manager of an ordinary internet gaming center, Joshua ran an illegal gambling den.The scam started when Joshua and his associates set up what appeared to be a legal business.
We will hire one guy of a legal age that he can own a business, of course. We will put a lump sum into his bank, but of course the account and everything is under his name, but the credit card, everything, the password is all in our hands. This unknown fella is obviously our friends. He will register down the legal shop, whether it's a restaurant, a billet salon, a barber, to a land shop,And so it means in the eyes of the law, it's legal. But what's happening behind the scene is a different story.
Operating licensed internet cafes and computer arcades, syndicates were able to run under-the-counter computer casinos in what appeared to be legitimate shops. Gambling software was installed on the computers, like live poker, roulette, and slot machines, similar to a real casino, where gamblers exchange cash for chips at the start.Joshua's clients paid for digital credits in order to play the games. This was money that the gamblers were told they could win back if they were lucky. But unlike true games of chance, these computer games were being manipulated by the syndicate.
I'll be very honest, okay? We actually can control the game, meaning they will never win. There's actually no chance of them winning big money.
As a prominent member of the gang, Joshua controlled five of these digital casinos.But Joshua was just one cog in the syndicate's machine. All the money he extracted from the gamblers ended up in the pockets of the boss, whose identity was carefully concealed.
We work for a boss. He's actually the chief of the gang. Okay, he will sponsor us the money. He will give us the contacts. Cut it short, you know, he give us the road and we walk here ourselves.
Joshua had his criminal lifestyle cut short when police raided one of his operations in 2007. Although his syndicate bosses had promised that they would protect Joshua from the law, they ended up betraying him. Joshua was abandoned by the criminal organization and was threatened with death if he ever dared to speak of their work again. Today, he urges those still involved to get out while they can.
Now they are fighting for all these people who are unknown. And what happens is that, who's going to face the music? I am. I will go to jail, okay, or maybe even die. Die in the streets, man. I have my friend who has three fingers all chopped off, attached back, but no longer in use. What's the point then? Come on, it's ridiculous.
Criminals in Asia's gambling underworld now have few places to hide. Authorities in Singapore continue to stay one step ahead of the game. The problem is that gambling is so addictive that the syndicates can always find new customers to exploit, and Asians seem especially vulnerable.
We've seen the data coming out of most established studies, and compared to the Western countries or the Caucasian populations, Orientals tend to be much more involved in risk-taking activities, especially gambling. It seems to be in the blood, so to speak. In our studies in general communities in China, in Hong Kong, Singapore, Macau, most of the time it would appear that approximately 2% of the population gets to be pathological gamblers.
Like hard drugs, gambling can lead anyone down the slippery slope to addiction, debt, and even death.
For example, the social problems of seeing family dysfunctions, family aggression when somebody gets involved in gambling. You're beginning to see the economic losses to family units. And when this happens, then we get even more other dysfunctional things happening, like activities where people get involved in illicit activities, getting involved in taking money, criminal breach of trust, and actual theft and other things just to feed their habit.
Chan became an addicted gambler after winning $20,000 in the national lottery. Hooked on the possibility of winning even more, Chan began to view gambling as a means of supporting his family. Chan's obsession took him on a roller coaster ride from lottery tickets to slot machines. And eventually, he found himself unable to go one day without gambling. Powerless to resist getting his daily gambling fix, Chan borrowed money from friends, from his younger sister, and even from illegal loan sharks. It was a vicious cycle that inevitably led to catastrophe. But there is help out there for compulsive gamblers. The Tanjong Pagar Family Service Center provides counseling support for addicts and for their families, who often suffer the most.
You have to understand that people who are involved in addictions tend to not be thinking rationally anymore. There's a part of their brain, the reward center, that kind of takes over. And this reward center drives you to want to continue even when you know all the risks.
Chan's wife issued him an ultimatum. He had to choose between his family and his addiction. On the brink of disaster, Chan sought counseling and today is happy to be in recovery, knowing just how close he came to losing everything. Although Chan was lucky, millions of others remain addicted across Asia. And as long as there are gamblers out there willing to risk it all for a shot at the jackpot, criminal organizations will seek to profit from illegal gambling. These illicit thrills are always short-lived, dangerous pleasures that cost people their possessions, their families, even their lives. And when all the cards are dealt, it's just not worth the gamble.